welcome to Legally Speaking with me, Tarun Nangia. Chief Justice of India, Justice N.V. Ramanna, called for greater representation of women as judges in court and said that they should shout with anger and demand 50% representation on the bench. With great difficulty, he said, we have achieved a mere 11% representation of women in the bench of the Supreme Court of India. But he added, women have continued to suffer in the profession and continue to face significant challenges even when they reach the top. So to discuss this important issue and all the comments that Justice Ramanna has made on this issue, we'll take them up one by one on the show. I have an eminent panel. I have with me Senior Advocate Pinky Anand. Ma'am has served as the Additional Solicitor General of India. I have with me Senior Advocate Priya Hingorani. I have with me Vanita Bhargava. She is partner, dispute resolution practice from Khaitan and Company. Ma'am Vanita Bhargava joins us for the first time on Legally Speaking. Welcome, Vanita, on the show. And welcome to the Legally Speaking Club. I have with me Meghna Mishra. She's an often seen face. You would have seen her on very important shows that we did. She is partner with Karanjawala and Company, one of India's leading litigation law firms. And we have a representation from the bench. We have Justice Iqbal Ansari, sir, has served as Chief Justice of the Patna High Court. And he would give the other view after my panelists have spoken, because we also need a view from the bench on these kind of issues. So thank you for sparing time and joining us. So I will start by welcoming my whole panel. And may I request Ma'am Pinky Anand to open this discussion with her opening comment on this issue.
Tarun, actually, I'll tell you one thing. What I find very fascinating is when our public and eminent people, our leaders in the section that we are talking about and in the country, actually voice a concern which percolates down to the masses, because that message which is sent down actually reverberates. And the reverberation is what you need. These kind of issues require a public attention as much as a decision-making at the top. So when you're talking about movements such as this, where you're talking about representation, whether it's in the judiciary, whether it is in political circles, whether it's in the executive, whether it's in the parliament, the whole concept is, one is, of course, the legal and the constitutional aspect as to whether you can have it by law. The second, ultimately, is the demand and the reverberation that I was talking about. And that, I think, the resonance that the Chief Justice of India, I was there when the Chief Justice spoke, and it was, in fact, one of the first parties that was hosted to felicitate the nine judges that were appointed. And in fact, interestingly, Tarun, it was also this, that when the party was held by the women Supreme Court lawyers, basically it was a question of whether you will have only the women judges which will be felicitated, or indeed the entire nine judges who were recently appointed in one of the biggest and greatest ceremonies that did take place in the Supreme Court auditorium, as it did in physical senses. So to have that message sent across during such troubled times, and to bring forth the perspective of the fact that this issue requires great attention, not only just in passing or in reference. It was a focal point of discussion and a statement. And I think that is what makes a difference. And I'm indeed grateful for this. It may happen in the form of reservation. It may happen otherwise. But the point is, it must happen. The starting has been made by him. And there are no better words than the fact that he's done it. He's actually appointed three women judges.
I find it very beautiful because, I mean, you all know better than me. You have to go through the law colleges and see the kind of talent that we have in law colleges that are women. They can be the best lawyers in law firms, but can also do great work on the bench. Times have really changed. And I think what we see in other fields, we can also see that transition in law. But I'll highlight a fact with the Chief Justice of India, Justice N.V. Ramanna did. Citing statistics on the representation of women, he informed that women constitute less than 30% of the strength of the lower judiciary, while at the High Court, and that's where the real problem is, the High Courts are a real problem, only 11.5% judges are women. And if there are not enough women judges in the High Court, it's unexpected that there'll be more in the Supreme Court. So a very quick comment from Pinky Anand, and I'll go to Priya Hingorani on this.
Tarun, there is also, as you said, very rightly, you see, look at the percentages as quoted by the Chief Justice, 30% to 11.5 to less than 11.5 in the Supreme Court. This is actually the principles of leaky pipelines. So basically, as you go upwards, in any case, there is reduction in numbers. The lesser representation is always there. So at the top, then the second question is of glass ceiling. You have a glass ceiling concept. So you have people possibly at the lower level of the pyramid, and judges, for example, so 30%, which is also not sufficient, but 30% is still a reasonable figure as far as representation is concerned. But that transfers on to a meager less than 11% at the Supreme Court and only about 11% at the high courts. And that indeed reflects, as you rightly said, you go down the law school corridors and you find enough and more meritorious women. So it's not a question of only reservation. The question is to recognize the merit, to give due opportunity, and it's a question of equal opportunity. Yes. That's all that really one wants, whether by way of a social change, whether by way of a legal change, whether by way of a reservation, whatever it takes, there's no time to wait for that.
And I'll take this point to Senior Advocate Priya Hingorani. The Chief Justice of India said, I'm also forcing the executive for applying necessary correctives. I'm happy to have colleagues in the collegium who are progressive and determined to bridge the gap in the higher judiciary. Now, of course, the judiciary is critical of the executive whenever they falter. But look at what has happened in the political sphere. A woman prime minister, many women chief ministers, many women chief secretaries. So I think governing and holding positions, a lot of women police commissioners also. So that is not an issue. So this is where the judiciary has been found wanting. What would you like to say?
I agree, Tarun. And this is, I think, something which we discussed in one of our earlier shows also, that why shouldn't we push for more? And why is it that the mindset has still not changed in so many years of the judicial system? We are, of course, very happy with the appointment of the women judges in Supreme Court. And this was a program which we did with you earlier, where we were congratulating each other and the Honorable Chief Justice and the Collegium for these appointments. But yes, the fundamental issue and the underlying concern is that, you know, we have, right from college, right in the various high courts, very, very meritorious women lawyers practicing across the country. But again, when it comes to considering them for appointment to the high court as judges, they fall out on the fact that they are women. Despite the fact that they are meritorious, better sometimes than the colleagues, which are male colleagues who are considered, but just because of the fact that they are women, they, you know, take a second position. So we definitely need to work on the thought process of the collegiums in different high courts to make them understand or make them realize, and what Justice Ramanna has said, that he's urging, of course, the various high courts to consider women, more women seriously. But when you talk of the legislative, you know, when the names are sent by the collegium for confirmation to the government, very often we find that women lawyers' names are sent back. And very often you will find that they are not reiterated as well. I mean, we have some cases of the recent past. I won't take names, but it's happened. Two male judges were cleared. They were appointed. The rest of the names came back. And we don't know what is the position. So why can't take this very seriously, that if a name has been recommended, of course it's been recommended with due consideration from any high court, give them that credit. If the name is recommended by the Supreme Court collegium, obviously they have done their due diligence and their names have been recommended. So yeah. Why send them back?
So very good point made by Senior Advocate Priya Hingorani. I'm sure the bench would take note of the collegium, the reiterations that you have said that don't happen. I'll go to Meghna Mishra, partner Karanjawala and Company. Chief Justice Ramanna said lack of infrastructure, gender stereotyping, force women to bear the brunt of family burdens and social attitudes that have plagued the entry and progress of women in the legal profession. Now, despite this, we see people like you, people like Vanita, who have become partners in one of India's leading firms. Vanita in Khaitan and company, you in Karanjawala, have achieved that level, but you, do you think you're one of the lucky few who have made it, Meghna?
I think, Tarun, it's also about timing and where you find yourself. And so, and I think I've said this earlier, I've been in a firm where, you know, we have more women partners than male partners. And I think there are very few firms like that. But, you know, and what when the Chief Justice acknowledges on a platform of, and when he speaks to the public about the need for gender parity in the judiciary, in the legal sector, in its entirety, when he acknowledges the lack of infrastructure, even toilets, he had mentioned that they're in the 6,000 odd trial courts, which are there, 22% don't even have women toilets. So there are other issues apart from just reservation or just being able to be at the right place. I do find now a lot more women are there in the high courts. I don't know about outside of Delhi, but I believe in the smaller towns still, it is extremely male-dominated profession even now. And if we take correctives, definitely sends a very positive signal. And it will have an effect and it will impact the profession as a whole. And you will find that more and more girls and women will come forward and will make an attempt. So small things like there being creches available where the children could be kept while women lawyers are appearing. And I think...
Meghna, you were very right. Sorry to interrupt you, but...
No, please.
What the Chief Justice of India said, I would like to read out.
Please.
Clients' preference for male advocates, though I see that changing rapidly. A lot of time I see clients wanting to interact with female, they find them genuine. I don't know. It's a very wrong statement to make. But they say we want to have women advocates. They're sincere. I don't know what that means. Even now, men are also sincere. But that is what some clients do say.
No, but there is no doubt, Tarun, that women are more sincere, more empathetic. They bring a lot more to the table than you do as a man. Because you see, women ultimately, you know, we all live our lives and we do have the obligations of families, etc. It is difficult. It you know, especially there are a lot of challenges that are faced. So, you know, as society, if we are more empathetic to the situation and if we help each other, we extend our arm rather than push them down.
That's why the Chief Justice said having women judges will improve the quality of justice
delivery. Absolutely.
So he wants more women judges. That's a good thing. Now going ahead, he also talks of uncomfortable environment within the courtrooms. Any visit to our district courts, anybody who's visited will know what we are talking
Absolutely.
About.
Absolutely. And when he notes that even washrooms are not available.
Washrooms are not available. The courtrooms are very crowded. It can be tough for even a man. I mean, why push men into a crowded environment? Even for women, but for men also. So all these deter women from entering the profession. I think by profession, he meant litigation and the bench. Of course, in law firms, things are different. So I'll go to Vanita. Vanita, you in your own right are an achiever. In a sense, people and a lot of women lawyers, students look up to you as an achiever. First, if you can share with us that you call yourself as an outlier who succeeded despite these kind of limitations. And what do you make of the Chief Justice of India's comments?
Yeah, Tarun. Like what Meghna said, you have to be at the right time at the right place. So frankly, when I started the profession, there were not that many women lawyers, not that many women lawyers in leadership positions. When I joined Khaitan & Company as a partner, I was one of the only two women partners. And now we have around 16 women partners over a span of 15 years. So things have improved. Nowadays, women cannot say that we have taken up leadership positions only because we were, you know, there were other factors playing, apart from the merits. Women have always counted on various other factors like support system and, like what Meghna said, at least in a metropolitan city like Delhi, I mean, people in other parts of the country are facing much more challenging situations. Now, as far as what Justice Ramana said, that I agree that women are grossly underrepresented in the judiciary. But what I do not agree is the means to increase the representation, that is reservation of seats in law colleges or in the judiciary. I don't consider that as a long-term solution to address the issue. In fact, some states have provided quotas for women in lower judiciary, you know, to name a few like Arunachal Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand, Telangana. Now, even there, even after the reservation provided, the proportion of women judges in states, vary. Like, for example, Telangana has 40% representation of women judges in the lower judiciary. But Bihar and Jharkhand, even in spite of the reservation, they fall short of the national average. So therefore, we have to look at the other systemic factors, you know, plaguing the society as such. It's a long haul. It's a long-term solution to really go to the root of the problems, like what Justice Ramanna himself had said, like you have mentioned, that what are the factors? There are, he himself has said that, you know, the attitude towards women has to change, the prejudices that are underlying, you know, and then the system of how do you, you know, appoint the judges. I mean, it is also rooted to judicial reforms in the selection of judges. Usually in the lower judiciary, if there are 30% representation, why doesn't it reflecting towards the higher judiciary? Because we know as a matter of fact that most of the appointments in higher judiciary is from the bar. And where the bar is concerned, you know, women still face a lot of discrimination. Like you said, yes, things are changing. A client's attitude is changing that they are sincere. But when it comes to arguing counsel, there is still a prejudice that women are not aggressive. And only aggressive lawyers are successful.
Justice Iqbal Ansari, he served as the Chief Justice of Patna High Court. Now, sir, you come from the Northeast where you served most of your career before you served in Patna. It is known as a society where equality is more than in the other parts of the country. Keeping that fact in mind, what has been your experience of representation of women in the judiciary and then the comments made by our Chief Justice?
See, Northeast, Tarun, is slightly different from the mainland India. In the Northeast, and in particular in Assam, a representation of female in the profession of law is quite high, not as low as it appears to be in other parts of the country. But so far as other states are concerned in Northeast, they are working definitely. More women have come than what they used to be in the past. But things are improving. Justice Ramanna's comments, and he's exhorting the people to make more representation in the judiciary. We have to remember that in the judiciary, representation cannot be increased unless there is a larger number of women lawyers. And there the difficulty actually arises. What can we do as a society dominated by men, which can help women come up in the profession of law? Of course, individuals like Pinky Anand are very rare. But it's not the only, she is the one who did it long time back. Now things have improved. The difficulty is that the Supreme Court does not assign any reason for not accepting a recommendation.
Yes.
If that is opaque, we don't know why. And many a times it is the woman lawyer who falls out. So if we are given the reason, then definitely it will help even the High Court in recommending the name in future. And it will definitely make anyone who is concerned with the court given the responsibility of making recommendation to select appropriate persons for the bench. As far as Delhi is concerned, let us be very clear that it is quite a different ball game. But other parts of the country is still seething with ignorance. UP, Bihar, you name it, it's very bad.
It's very bad. But
there we need to increase the representation of the women both in the profession of law and also in the judiciary.
You've made, sir, some good points from sir. In fact, Vanita also echoed some points which Justice Ansari made, specifically the points of Bihar and UP. The situation really needs to improve. But I think that could be true for other parameters of governance also in those states. It's not just law. I'll go to Senior Advocate Pinky Anand. Ma'am, the Chief Justice of India said, the survey I directed found that out of 6,000 trial courts, nearly 22% have no toilets for women. Point number one. Point number two, he said, we need to create a more welcoming environment. He proposed that, you know, a National Judicial Infrastructure Corporation, he has proposed for that. That project is attempting to change the infrastructure. Now, I want to ask you two questions. Now, it is nobody's case that senior advocates won't go to trial courts to argue. They have been going, they do go. Now, they must be finding it embarrassing that going to a trial court and not even finding a toilet, it is beyond embarrassing. Do you think that the Chief Justice of India is taking the bull by the horns and finally attempting to solve this? We need money. Now even a lot of municipal buildings are world-class. Courts should be world-class, and there is not much money that is required to do that.
Tarun, I think this is one of the most brilliant statements. In addition to giving a position of strength to women in terms of whether by reservation or otherwise in proportionality, judicial and the legal infrastructure, so to say, the courts, the buildings, the toilets, I think is something which has needed redress for a long time. We've just been, in a sense, not giving it enough priority or not giving it enough precedence. So it's a good occasion, even if it's through gender or otherwise, to come to that. As a matter of course, I have started from the trial court. So I know exactly what we are talking about. But there are two other factors which are important. One, I think the Chief Justice has done something to the same effect and tenor as the Prime Minister Modi did when in 2014, when he was sworn in as the Prime Minister. At that point in Redford itself, girls' toilets, incidentally, was an issue raised, and that was heading towards girls' education also, because girls would not go to school, therefore not get enough education because there weren't enough toilets, etc. So this entire movement of issues of infrastructure, which facilitate, definitely this requires an address in the first possible form. Secondly, so it's not only the question of toilets, and as far as the second aspect is concerned, I must flag that too. When you go to trial court, the general feeling is that women are timid, women are not, distracted, let's say, or swayed by the kind of mahal, as they say, which is around in the trial courts. But at the same time, I think women also must be made stronger. You just can't let the world get to you and say, I'm not strong enough, or I am too glamorous, or I have to maintain that dignity. So trial court can be quite a bit of fun, incidentally, aside from the fact that toilets is not a matter of desirability, it's a necessity and must be addressed, because women cannot go if not taken care of.
And would I ask you, you came from Harvard in the United States of America and practiced in a trial court here. It must be a shock for you to be thrown in such a condition 30 years ago when gender sensibilities in this city were also very different.
Fortunately, Tarun, yes. Yes and no. In the sense, I grew up in Old Delhi and had the advantage of coming up pretty rough and tough. I came from a school which dealt with most situations which enabled me to face general society. I went into public life. So I was able to, you know, going even for elections in Delhi University is not an easy run. You have to face quite a bit of environment. So at the same, I wasn't really taken aback so badly. But yes, the first 2-3 days I went to trial court was a shock. Coming from an American, I even practice in America. So coming from a routine where your margins and your grammar and your presentation and your habits itself was a major issue of concern. Going to a thesis, and somebody says, "Mota kagaz leke application haath se likh do." It's quite a terror by itself, and then going there. But I think that one can grow to enjoy. However, what you need to get past is the fact that today we are on a different answerability system. It's a long time since the days when women are now going, presenting, men are going. We need a good environment where you can present to the world at large. And as you said, even corporations have grand infrastructures. Why not courts which present themselves, whether they are trial courts, whether the high courts and all are pretty good in most parts of the world, country today. But why not the trial courts also?
You've made a couple of good points. I'll go to Senior Advocate Priya Hingorani. Ma'am, in your family, judicial issues have been discussed since childhood. You also have campaigned for a lot of transformation. I want to ask you, when you travel abroad and when they see at India, do you think our image goes down because of our judicial infrastructure is so poor?
While I would say I'm a brand ambassador for India, the one thing which strikes apart for the Indian judicial system is the fact that the our judges are able to handle so many matters in a day. I mean, the Supreme Court takes 70 to 80 matters on a miscellaneous day, and they are able to, you know, cope through that burden of cases, or even on a non-miscellaneous day. District courts, high courts, you take it, the kind of, the level of work that is involved for our judges is commendable, and this is talked about across the world. It's not in any, either in UK or US. But yes, when we talk about infrastructure, definitely in different, in the other parts of the world, the population is less, the infrastructure is more organized. And I think, yes, we need to learn from them as far as organization of the infrastructure is concerned. And I think the states have a responsibility towards the judicial system to put together a right infrastructure for the courts, for the judicial, for the administration of justice. But at the same time, the workload, the population, the backlog, and that's why I think whether it is the judiciary itself or the lawyers or the litigants who are, you know, asking again and again for more appointments of judges, because, you know, when their sanctioned strength are one particular court is more than 100 and then you have only 50% judges there, naturally the work will suffer. So I think it's a collective effort by the legislative as well as executive and the courts, the collegium system, to put together, you know, the things at par with the international standards. Having said that, I must say that, yes, you know, steps have been taken by various high courts. We can see that happening. There is a delay. There are a lot of other compulsions which come across before the collegium system. And I think that's where we really need to, you know, introspect and see why should we let compulsions or interference, I would word be, use a strong word like interference, come in the point when the collegium system has to decide on meritorious lawyers to be, you know, recommended for elevation. I think that's something we really need to introspect and look at.
Point well taken. Now, going to Meghna Mishra, ma'am, because you work for a law firm, infrastructure is not that much of an issue unless when you go to a court. Your colleague at Karanjawala and Company, Mr. Ram Karanjawala, once said that the fines that you levy to the litigants, the penalties that you levy, that money can be used for improving district court infrastructure. Do you think that can be made possible, that when they levy 10, 20, 15 lakh rupee fines, or maybe levy slightly more fine and then use that money to improve toilets and other, get the basics right? Do you think that is a do?
Yes, I do. In fact, you know, in the High Court of Delhi, now trees, instead of costs being imposed, there are directions to plant trees. So, of course, it can be directed to be put to use as deemed fit. And so why not to improve our own system and make the district courts better? But, you know, I think that it needs to be a concerted effort, and all participating, whether it is the lawyers or the judges, everyone must come together. And I think if the Chief Justice is taking this step and taking this forward, we all at this time must come together to help support and take it forward. Because like all of us have been saying, it needs to be at the level of law colleges. It needs to ensure that women are able to join the profession, then not drop out, you know. Yes.
All the women coming from the best law colleges in India with the best infrastructure. And when they want to do litigation, they end up in these places where even the judges can't sit. Specifically, it's not even a good sitting, except for Delhi. I mean, most areas, district courts are not in a good shape. But I'll go to Vanita Bhargav at this point. Now, again, you are also an outlier. Being in a law firm, infrastructure is all good. But because you are part of the dispute resolution team, you have a lot of litigation work. With what the Chief Justice of India has said, what hopes do you have? And because we sit in Delhi, you know, a lot of things change here first. What hopes do you have?
The fact that the Chief Justice raised this and we're having this discussion and various other discussions have started on this issue, I think that itself, you know, shows that there is hope. You know, discussion would lead to certain ideas, and ideas hopefully will get executed. As far as, I mean, I think the Chief Justice used the word socially conscious architecture, to be in place. And he himself highlighted, and one of the systemic evils, like we said, was that why women drop out. You know, there are there was a study that 2019, almost 44% of the candidates of CLAT were women. But then why don't we see it, to the top? Why don't we see those numbers, replicated to the top? So one point on infrastructure that, apart from, of course, the basic necessity of a toilet, I think Meghna also mentioned, we need to have an environment like creches or, where women who fall out, ma'am said about leaking pipelines, that most of the women, don't practice because they have to take care, they're being the primary caregiver. I mean, that fact also needs to be changed, I think, at some level from primary education level, that mindset. That, women, men also needs to contribute equally, if not more, at home. So there has to be, the infrastructure should also take care where a woman can, be more comfortable with her family. I mean, basically, that is the main reason, that they have to take care of their children and they can't get them. I know of friends who used to make their children wait in the car outside while they are attending court and arguing in the court. Yes, this it seems hopeful that these discussions.
That's a good point, and we all are very happy also because the Chief Justice of India that we have now is very vocal. He's very vocal. He will speak his mind out. It feels happy when the Chief Justice of India speaks his mind out. There is nothing that we wait for him to speak for months, then he'll say something. He's vocal.
One more point, Tarun. The fact that I'm a advocate for the virtual court system. I feel that virtual system, I understand that many people would not have the wherewithal. I mean, that has to be addressed. But that is very good for women who need to work from home, especially of taking care of the family. I think that would, in fact, close the gap, if a virtual system is encouraged and some sort of a hybrid system is developed, considering the technology and other factors.
Point well taken. One last comment from Justice Ansari. Now, sir, you are father to a daughter. Of course, she is not in the profession of law, but doing equally well, more well. The Chief Justice of India, Justice N.V. Ramana, is also father to two daughters. Now, it should not be left unsaid that when there are women in the house and there is a father, of course, the environment is very different. They understand these issues. There is an empathy for the issues women face because you're a father to a daughter. What I want to ask is that Justice Ramana said in his parting comment, the reality remained that the legal profession is yet to wholeheartedly welcome women into its fold. What would you like to say on that?
That is, again, I said, different from different places. And Justice Ramana, as the statements have been made in the capacity of Chief Justice, has done great thing by making this kind of an open declaration. But if you recall, a few years back, infrastructure was one of the important issues, even before the Supreme Court. Once a week, there used to be a bench which take up matters. So those, and it was the same situation in other high courts. Infrastructure very improved. In fact, I was horrified when I found in Bihar that the district courts do not have, in all the districts, the toilet for women. This was not even known to me. And but it is my own feeling that if the Chief Justice of India takes really good care and exhorts his colleagues at the high court level, this problem of infrastructure, at least the bare minimum element necessities, can be filled up.
Okay. Point well taken. In fact, on another show, we discussed that why commercial courts and other courts shouldn't have world-class infrastructure. You have the best corporate companies. They are filing suits on commercial matters. Courts all over the world have great infrastructure. Why shouldn't India? But that's for another show that we will take up. I would like to thank Senior Advocate Pinky Anand, Justice Iqbal Ahmed Ansari, Meghna Mishra from Karanjawala and Company, Vanita Bhargav from Khaitan and Company, Senior Advocate Priya Hingorani, all of you, for sparing time at a short notice and joining on such a positive issue. When the Chief Justice of India himself talks of changing things, we all can think of hope and of better times to come. And with this National Judicial Infrastructure Corporation, I think within his tenure, if he can make some announcement and get work started, I think that would be his greatest gift or greatest contribution to judiciary for all of us. Thank you so much. Thank you.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.